Wow, that was great. My name is Audrey, and I'm a neuroscientist at Caltech, and I want to tell you about what I work on here at Caltech. So what I work on here in my lab is we actually study sleep. Let me ask you a question. If you want to study the brain, do you want to look at that in the brain where it's kind of enclosed in a skull that you can't see through, or do you want to see it in a transparent box? I think it's a transparent box. So one thing that's really good is that we actually have this already in nature. We have a brain in a glass box. We have something where you can see straight through an organism and see their brain. And so what we can do is zoom in on the brain and look at these neurons. What I'm showing you here is actually neurons, and each one of them are colored in a different color. So it's actually neurons in technicolor. And what these neurons are these are hypocretin neurons. Does anyone know anybody with narcolepsy? Have you guys heard of narcolepsy? Narcolepsy is a sleep disorder where actually you're always kind of sleepy. And when you get stimuli that excites you or something that is, I guess, your brain food, instead of being excited, which is kind of the normal thing to do, you actually fall asleep. So these neurons I'm showing you here are actually the neurons that are involved with that. So when you have all these neurons in different colors in the brain, the important thing is, how do they connect with one another? We have all these tracks. How many of you guys here have taken public transportation? Public transportation? Woohoo! So when you have public transportation, what's important is where are those points of contact and where do all those different tracks lead? And so similar to that, we are constructing a system map. And so one of the ways we want to do this is we take the cues by how we interact with other humans. So when we have another human, one thing that we do is we give a handshake. So what Professor Corey Bargman did is that she designed a way to do a molecular grasp. So I am neuron Audrey, this is neuron Ella, and we each have this glove that's not lighting up, but when we make contact, we actually have our gloves lighting up. And when we are further away, we actually, the lights go off. So this is a way to figure out how those neurons are connecting to each other, and we can actually see, when these neurons are talking to each other, when they're close enough to each other, and when they're further apart from each other. So I want to talk about my motivation to study science. I want to study science because I like to test ideas and observe what happens. So what we actually do is we want to make sure we're making a fair comparison. When we have an apple, we want to compare it to an apple. And when you want to make a comparison, you want to make sure you're comparing an orange to an orange. So in these controlled conditions, we actually have lots of different controls. We have positive controls and negative controls. You have your positive controls to make sure when you're actually testing something, you can see an effect. You have your negative controls to make sure you don't have auto-activation, and so that when you don't have introduction of your experimental condition or stimuli that you're testing, it's not going to just go off. And then you have your experimental condition. And actually, when we design an experiment, you have lots of positive controls. You have lots of negative controls, and you have your experimental condition. And one trend that we're seeing in neuroscience is that we are actually seeing that we can observe and test our idea. And what these scientists are is we're actually kind of like little ninjas and just quietly looking at the brain. And so that's what Alex and his friends have done. What they do is they take these brains that are in glass boxes and they are swimming or they're sleeping, doing whatever they want. And at the same time, they're capturing the neural activity. The way they do this is that they've actually genetically engineered so that these neurons each give off a photon of light, and the more these brains are active, the more these more photons are going to come out, so you see a greater illuminescence. And so while these fish are just doing their regular business, these brains in glass boxes are doing their regular business, we actually can observe neural activity. Let's say we want to do this a little bit further, an entire human population. And so what if we were to just look at the entire human population, their native environment, and let's say we take away those positive and negative controls and just have experimental conditions. What if we have something like a wiki log, a wiki lab notebook, where everyone's contributing their ideas, and then as each person's contributing their ideas and writing over one another, kind of like Wikipedia, Who would have thought Wikipedia would have gone off the way that it did with all its success? But it did. And what if we could apply that to science? It's a little different than what we can think about now, and we have these apples and oranges, and usually we can't compare them to one another, but now we have all these different conditions and things like maybe weird fruits like dragon fruit. And we want to compare those, and so I want to give you the challenge to be the ones, to be the mathematicians, the statisticians, to design these type of algorithms, be able to decide whether or not we can extrapolate trends and figure out these observations without all those controls. So change the way we do science, go change the world. Thanks.